Hello, and thank you for tuning in to the Final Draft Right On podcast. I'm Pete D'Alessandro, your host and product manager here at Final Draft. This is the screenwriting podcast where we talk about all things filmmaking. Today's guest created Bodyguard for Amazon. His name is Jed Mercurio, and Michael C. Bryan's going to be interviewing him, talking about that show. Here's Michael C. Bryan in conversation with Jed Mercurio.
Hello there, Jed.
Yeah, hi.
Oh, lovely. Nice to meet you. How are you?
Yeah, I'm good. I'm good, thank you. Thanks so much for inviting me on the podcast.
Oh, this is, no, you. It really is my absolute honor. It's so nice of you to take the time to talk about what we're about to talk about. But before we get into all of that, how are you? How's your Monday been? I know it's later in the evening there.
Yeah, it's been a good day, thank you. Yeah, it's 7 p.m. here, right. And my show Line of Duty airs on a Sunday night, so it was episode 5 of a 6-episode season, went out last night, and yeah, we've had great feedback today in terms of ratings and audience reaction.
Brilliant. Well, I know we're talking about Bodyguard, and I first saw Bodyguard. I have a good friend of mine out in Los Angeles, Jen Grisanti, who helps a lot of people with writing and what have you. And she, like myself, I am American born, but I'm British blood. So she knows I'm a rather fiend for anything overseas. And she sent out an email about Bodyguard and said, "You're not prepared for what you're about to see." And we weren't, you know, we don't take those things lightly. I have to tell you, I'm going to do all I can not to wax poetically about it.
Okay.
I'm going to really do all I can, but it's rare that I find something that is so deeply my cup of tea.
Oh, thank you so much.
Oh, no, it's just, it's really quite brilliant. Not just thematically, but the love of the form, the precision. It's not often to find something riveting. When I can't move, it's kind of startling. And the opening of this, as I'm sure you've heard probably way too many times now, is just so shockingly good. And then how you had that turn at the end. And you don't strike me as a man who isn't clear that those things are necessary, while at the same time, and this is where I'm going with this, institutions, the way in which the workings, inner workings of organizations are run is really, I think, of a great interest to you. The satisfaction of that final beat tying into the opening, and for anyone who has not seen it, I'm sorry, but I'm not going to not talk about it. It's so lovely. You must have just felt so good about that.
Well, I think there's a lot of emphasis on opening episodes landing the themes and the characters and the style of a show. Mm-hmm. It's a crowded market out there. You get only one chance maybe to grab your audience. And certainly I always put a lot of time and work and thought into how a story begins and how we create the building blocks of that first journey that mm-hmm. you hope will draw the audience in and mm-hmm. acquaint them with the stakes of the story, acquaint them with the premise that you're offering up to them. And
I love how methodically you say that. You didn't just pull us in, you grabbed us by the lapels.
That's a great image.
That lovely. It's like some of the best Hitchcock. It's just that good. And I've studied suspense. Patricia Highsmith was a huge right, wasn't she lovely?
Yeah.
And her work, your work reminds me a bit of hers, but I interrupted. I'm so sorry. Please continue.
No, not at all. I'm always happy to pause for compliments. Yeah, I approach the opening of a series is to think in terms of delivering what an audience might understand is a chain reaction. So in the sense that to extend the analogy, you need a critical mass before you can create a chain reaction. But it's really about packing those story and character elements into the beginning of the show,
what a
to the point
concept.
Where the audience realizes you're heading towards a critical mass. It's going to explode. And that may, it may be slow chain reaction, or it may be a fast one. It may be violent, or it may be subtle. But I think the audience is very smart, and once they see those character plot combinations beginning to orbit each other, then I think that's when they kind of strap in, if you get it right.
Well, the metaphors you're using are, of course, brilliant, because we literally, there's not really, you know, there's an analogy between what's actually strapped upon her in the opening. And then, of course, and we'll get into this, but the wound of Bud and how this is made to split, right, that wide open. So he's forced to confront this without, by the way, I must, again, forgive me for the endless compliments, which you're going to have to endure. It wasn't hit too on the nose about the PTSD, which I thought was quite lovely. It just was. It wasn't something that was so, it's interwoven into it. So, okay, I'm going to back up a little bit. So institutions and how, was there a model you used to take a look at the workings of an institution, corruption, but then you laid a top of it, a thriller action. There's a couple set pieces that are astounding, but was there a model beforehand that you thought about for a thriller action piece that's interwoven with a discussion about the corruption, deep corruption upon layer about an institution? Was there a thought process prior to beginning this?
Well, I'm very fortunate as a writer that I can draw on personal experience. I was a hospital doctor before I became a full-time writer, and I have a lot of primary experience of what it's like to work in a very large institution. And having experienced other institutions such as TV networks, I've discovered that there are many universal truths of real institutions. So I tend to construct an institution based on what I would call a social realist insight. That I don't want to create faceless institutions with obscure names. I try and adopt a policy of inventing as little as possible. So sometimes that means you bump up against certain legal issues about what institutions you can depict in a fictional work. But generally, I try and be quite robust about that and do whatever I can to portray real police forces, real political parties, and the real institutions that are integral to the plot in Bodyguard. So as part of that process, we didn't invent any institutions at all. Everything within the show correlates to a real-world equivalent.
So you feel, well, do you, I shouldn't infer, but do you strongly feel that research when embarking on something like this is vital, or is it to augment what is already in your imagination?
It's more a process of augmentation. I'm not a person for doing an enormous amount of research before launching into a piece of work. I feel that the piece of work has to have a premise and a construction that exists outside of the research, something that is universal, so that if you presented it to a mainstream audience member, they would immediately get why it's a thriller, why it's a love story, or whatever it is. I think that the research is something which then allows you to add authentic procedure. And even if you are only showing glimpses of that, I think it helps add to the verisimilitude of the piece, which then grounds it in some kind of plausible reality for the audience.
Yeah, no, I completely agree with that. It's, you know, it's fascinating because, so the conscious process then for you as a writer, it's not so much to think tonally, this is where I'm going to go, but how to blend together factual, then imaginative thought process, and then populate it with characters that can live within that framework. That's a combination of two. Is that the thinking then?
Yeah, that's exactly right. And I think that also it's about identifying characters who are plausibly part of those institutions.
That's right.
I think an audience is smart enough to realize that a police officer can't behave in a certain maverick way and remain a police officer.
That's right.
And so you have to approach these things where you believe you can create a distinctive characters who aren't just very gray and ordinary, but on the other hand, they still have to be part of these institutions. And often that's what creates the conflict. Often the objectives and ideals of an institution can be at odds with those of the individual.
Well, that's perfect, because that's exactly the foundation for Julia and her line of action. And then that's also for Bud, Dave David as well, right? Because they're chosen and created in advance to obstruct and disrupt what's currently happening in search of, I don't want to say, what would you call it? In search of what?
I think you need to be a bit more specific there.
I think I do too, because I didn't want to fill it in. I wanted to hear your thoughts. Your beautiful mind. Because, like, you know, David is such a fascinating man, such a beautifully lovely, flawed, real. There's no artifice to this man. And so when he comes back okay, here's a question for you. When he was watching Julia on the monitor going, you know, on and on, and he saw that repetition from the PTSD perspective on the monitor of again and again and again, what did you imagine was going through him then? Because I'm fascinated to hear, did that precipitate the intimacy of the first time, or was it something else in there? I'm intrigued with that line there from your thoughts.
It's really about him seeing her as a functioning politician, mm-hmm. in terms of her relationship with the electorate, which right. is how he will have perceived politicians to that point. The fact that he's appointed to be her principal protection officer brings him close up to someone. And that's the first instance of him seeing her discussing the kinds of policies that she is advancing. And that's where he starts to have misgivings about what kind of person she is. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And also, before he embarks on his protection role, he does a little bit of background research on Julia and discovers that she's got a hawkish voting record. She's tended to vote in favor of military action in the Middle East, and she supported those operations, which are the source of his trauma. It creates a connection. And then when he witnesses her being so unapologetic for mm-hmm. the harm that those operations cause, not only the harm that they did to the servicemen who were sent overseas, but also the enormous amount of harm that was done to the countries that those operations took place in. What he then sees is someone who he has no real emotional connection with, someone that he can feel intellectually and emotionally antagonistic towards.
Mm-hmm. So that's fascinating, because that, of course, and that must have been thought about in advance, because it's a delicious sort of a domino structure here. The what, you know, is often called in circles that I run in the writing worlds as, you know, the wound of the main character is there and visible, and then of course the situation you're putting him into takes a salt shaker and says, "May I pour some salt into this wound?"
Yeah.
Right. So then we can then have a wound that has to be cleaned up. So, you know, that's fascinating, because, you know, I have to wonder, because of your life previously, is there a conscious integration on your part when you're talking about these dynamics and these complex psychological motivators and institutions that do you think about your life prior and about how to bring what you knew then and know now into these worlds you're talking about? So the dynamics here between David and Julia and also the institutions. Is that still being played out here for you?
I think it is, yeah. I think it's really important to be able to kind of reach inside and pull out things that are about how you feel about something, either emotionally or intellectually. And that then grounds the characters in a reality that works. If you sincerely believe that your own psychology and your own emotional life is not that dissimilar from a regular person, then it just allows you to imbue the characters with real ideals, real conflicts, real emotions. And it's all about finding plausibility. It's all about finding a journey for a character that an audience will regard as being truthful. That doesn't mean that something has to be the journey of almost everyone. It can be an almost unique journey, but it has to make sense psychologically.
Well, speaking of psychologically, so I just have to ask what the discussion was in the writer's room about why he decided that first time to be intimate with her. Because
there isn't a writer's room because I'm the only writer.
Oh, that's lovely. This is so lovely. I'm in heaven right now. So with you and your id.
Well, there's an editorial team, but I'm the only writer. Okay, so there's a couple of producers and the three of us are the ones who talk about the structure and the drafts of the script. But there's only one person who goes away and opens final draft and starts working on the script.
All right, then. So I guess in that room with yourself and your imagination, what was the thought process behind the first time that he decides to be intimate with her?
It was about finding a collection of circumstances which would destabilize their judgment. That if you've got two people who are in a professional setting, and also there's a hierarchy there, there's also an ethical side of it in terms of he's the bodyguard and she's the person who should be protected, but she has a lot of power. Mm-hmm. All those things are fighting against the idea of intimacy. So it feels that you need a particularly upsetting and destabilizing set of conditions, which was the action sequence in episode two where her life was in danger and he saves her life, and it's all incredibly frightening and destabilizing. But the other thing is that you have to be able to step back and ask yourself, what is it doing for the show overall? And because it's a thriller and there's a certain tension between these two characters, you have to invite the audience to look at other motivations beyond unbridled lust. You have to look at whether it's an act of manipulation on the part of one character or other or both.
Well, that's what's so lovely and brilliant, is that you're wondering what the motivators are. And as you said, in a thriller, you always want to keep us uncertain. There's a certain, I love when you say disruption and combustibility. You talked about that with the opening, but there's always a potential for things to go awry at any moment. And I really enjoy your desire to bring about managed chaos. I think it's rather enjoyable, particularly in this genre. But you've got a couple genres working here. You've got a love story. You've got institutional dissection, if you were. You've got a thriller mystery, too, also, which you layered in here. How conscious were you in writing this to think, at this moment, I'll withhold this amount of information? Were you looking to surprise yourself, or were you looking, I know what the answer is, I'm going to withhold this and let you make up your own mind?
I think it's a combination of more than one of those. I think that there are times as a writer when you find yourself on a particular path and you feel a sudden impulse to turn off, to take a different route, and wonder to yourself where that might lead. And I think that you've got to trust that instinct. If as a writer you're following an outline or a scene breakdown, or you're just riffing through scenes, if you feel that impulse, I think you've got to trust that your inner writer is telling you that it's got a bit predictable.
That's brilliant.
And then what you've got to do is just look at all the ramifications of the reckless impulse you're experiencing, and it may be that as you do that, what you will find is that there is one path that you hadn't thought about, but the story downstream is more interesting, and it's not destructive to take a different route, even if it's just for 10 or 15 minutes to just explore that and see where it leads. So in respect of those two characters embarking on a sexual relationship, there were a number of points in the story where that was a viable next step. And it was really about finding the right one, the one where it felt it occurred late enough that it was plausible, but early enough that there was a lot of story downstream.
You know what's lovely about what you're saying, which is really quite beneficial for other writers who are hearing this, is that when the impulse comes, don't question and overanalyze, follow it, and then let the actions in due course reveal themselves, and then step back and maybe look at what would be the results of those actions, perhaps.
That's right. It's about having the professionalism to explore the ramifications of your impulses. The worst thing you can do is ignore them.
That's correct.
And think, well, I've got this outline here. I've got this treatment that the network are really excited about. What I should do is just stick to plan A. Even if you explore other ramifications and you decide that none of them lead anywhere. What you have identified is that possibly there's a predictability problem, and you need to look at whether that's something which is local to the area of the story you're in, or whether it's a more systemic problem.
Well, so really what we're talking about is, and this is, you know, with your interest in institutions and turning them upside down, you're actually doing that with the writing process as well, which is fantastic. I think a lot of writers doubt that. You know, I think a lot of writers feel that once that outline is set, then there we are, then I need to stick to that because my points have been found. But that's not really where much of the juice comes, does it?
That's exactly right. I think that you have to regard an outline as part of a process.
That's
and
cool. Yeah, yeah.
It's the same as delivering a first draft and then saying you're not going to do any further work. That's insane.
It is insane. That's insane.
No professional writer is going to be able to continue a career with that approach. So there's no real difference fundamentally between doing a running redraft of an outline and doing a second draft of a screenplay. They are exactly the same process.
You know, how much fun, how much did you, how much surprise was there? How much did you revel a bit in your own cleverness to also, and it's, I use clever lightly. I think clever is an overused term that indicates a lack of craft and emotional truth. So the withholding of the viewing of but in the briefcase, the question of motive and things as such, how often were you surprised by where what was being revealed to you down these thorny paths you were going and thought, oh dear, that's rather fun? Did that happen to you often?
I think that is all part of the process if you're writing a thriller.
It's so enjoyable.
If you're trying to create mystery, then there is an analytical process that goes on about just how much story do you need to tell for an audience to be in that sweet spot, which yeah. is they don't know so little that they're hopelessly confused, but they right. don't know enough that they can predict what's going to happen next.
Well, that briefcase is a perfect example.
Yes. And so those are the kinds of turning points in a story that have to be explored. There are always pros and cons. It may be that if you reveal the MacGuffin at this particular junction, then what will happen is that it will increase the stakes, will increase audience participation in the story, and possibly propel you forwards in a more dynamic way. But there is nothing more powerful across episodes, and by that I mean across the border of episodes, than a question to be answered. It's okay, I think, when you're within an episode of a TV series to show things and use those to propel you forward. But I think that when you're getting towards the end, and what you're attempting to do is get an audience to engage to the point where they're going to come back and either hit the play button, or they're going to have to wait a week if it's linear programming, then you need a more powerful tool. And the most powerful is curiosity.
That's right. And I think the implementation of, you know, MacGuffin, you must have studied some Hitchcock, I would imagine.
I've watched a lot of Hitchcock movies.
I would imagine. And,
I think that what's interesting is watching the difference between suspense and revelation, and Hitchcock was a master of doing that.
Master of withholding just enough to drive you a little to the brink, and then answer, and then spin another question off of that answer.
That's right. And also what's notable about Hitchcock is that the cinematic techniques that he employed visually weren't that complex.
His
coverage was very conventional. So it's much more about the way in which he constructed those scenes. Now, if you look at much more contemporary filmmaking, what you'll see there is so much more coverage, so many more shots, that it allows you to make choices in the edit that weren't available to Hitchcock because he had less coverage.
Yeah, he was also notorious, you know, that lovely book with Truffaut where he talked often about his process and how he had very clear storyboards. He would not deviate from those storyboards. Those were what he shot. There is, and was there a thought process on your end too? There is in Bodyguard a very clear, someone is in control. Someone is clearly mapping out where my eyes are going, where I'm going. It's a lovely feeling of someone knows where this boat is being, you know, driven, even though I'm sitting in the back, rocking back and forth and laughing hysterically, not knowing where I'm going. But I feel that the boat knows where it's going. Is that something in your life as a writer, as a person, that you possess? Because it's very clear in Bodyguard, like someone is in control here.
Well, I think part of that comes from being a showrunner. Part of that comes from being on the set a lot, in the edit, having that constant dialogue with directors and cast and any other relevant heads of department. So there is an overall vision for a piece, and it is a genuine dialogue. It's a very collaborative process, and having those discussions does allow you to explore whether you're delivering on the goals that you've set yourself. So the other thing, I suppose, is the sense that there's an answer. If you are familiar with examples, I'm not going to name any examples of movies or TV shows which are so opaque that you just lose interest. You actually feel that the The story elements are too disjointed to ever come together in an overall explanation of the questions you're seeking answers to.
There's too many examples to name on this podcast.
Whereas I think if you can make it clear to the audience what the question is they should be asking, you don't need a character to verbalize that question, but to just boil it down to something very simple like, who's the killer? The audience will buy into that.
Right. It's very refreshing, isn't it? When you find somebody who just simply asks that and then follows that line of action.
Yeah. I think the approach that I would take to a thriller is having some very simple questions that are being asked by the story structure. So a very simple question that's being asked in Bodyguard is David Budd going to kill Julia? Mm-hmm. And then a question that's asked later in the series is, did David Budd kill Julia? It's as simple as that. Mm-hmm.
So really the shell game, the hiding of the seams is not so contingent upon reinventing the question, but how to answer the question. How to keep people guessing for the answer to the question. Is that about right?
Yeah, and to extend the analogy of the shell game, it's no accident that the shell game is classically played with three shells.
Well, that's why I brought that up, because it's so clear continue. You could articulate it better than I, but that's why I brought that up, yeah.
Yeah, because the question that is being asked by three shells is sufficiently simple and sufficiently complex. That if you had more shells or fewer shells, then the question wouldn't work.
No, but that's what's so lovely. I mean, you take those three elements and then you play and toy with those, you know, and you don't need to add more. It's like, for some reason, I saw the flash of Strangers on a Train in my mind and how there's really not many shells there, but they're played beautifully to maximum effect. And that's really something that, you know, you've done so well. That must be a fascination for you, because the construct, we could talk about this all evening, in Bodyguard is so correct in that it satisfies but surprises. That's difficult to do. Were you rather, I mean, I'm going to say it again, were you rather pleased with the way in which, first of all, you took out Julia when you did, and then all bets are off at that point, we realize, and then have that final beat with her in the finale? I mean, did this come to you, or was this something you knew early on as you were writing?
There was always a plan that it would be a symmetrical story.
There was
always a plan that the major story event would be exactly at the midpoint, and that it would then propel you into a different equilibrium post that event. And the protagonist is then working to restore the order that he experienced at the beginning. So it's almost like there's a checklist of things that he has to go through in order to answer certain questions, to right certain wrongs. And on that journey, he also ends up with having started the journey towards healing his wound.
Right. And that's really what's so lovely about the construct of this. And I think that it's important for writers to hear this. How did you find Bud's journey in terms of his wound, PTSD? Because it's larger than just PTSD, of course. And was the thought process, I have a character here who is suffering from this seismic psychological wound that is not always visible but prevalent in his life, and then I'm going to put him into a situation in which we exasperate that wound? Was that a thought process in advance?
Yeah, it was initially a very simple story asset, which is, if we are to ask the audience to believe that it's possible for a specialist protection officer to be an assassin, what are the factors that that would make that person act in that way. So one of those is mental instability, that for whatever reason, his judgment fails or he experiences impulses he's unable to control. And then being able to connect it to what his enmity towards his possible antagonist is felt like the simplest solution. So making him a soldier who'd served in conflicts that were ordained by the person he's protecting and have him be traumatized by those conflicts to the point where he may suffer a loss of impulse control and do her harm. All that felt very logical and plausible.
You know, what's lovely about that is I think writers, particularly when they're beginning to find their voice and their tone, and correct me if you feel I may be wrong, they tend to overcomplicate what you just did, which is a beautiful, clear dissemination of this cause and effect. This is to exasperate this. There's a very clear process here, isn't there?
Completely. And because the premise of the series was something that came as really part of a trio of ideas, the last being that the protector might also be the assassin.
I just love that. I love that.
The idea then was, well, what are the things that might induce a protector to be an assassin?
Lovely.
Yeah, so it was a thought process. And one of those, in addition to that, is that he's got nothing to lose, which is why his marriage is failing. And in the first episode, he finds out that his wife has moved on. She's seeing someone new. And that's why he says to her, let's not get divorced, because if anything happens to me, you'll still get the pension, you'll still get the compensation. So we establish that he feels, whether rightly or wrongly, that he's got less to live for than he had at the start of the story.
Yeah, you know, those moments are they're lovely to behold, because you can see Richard Madden, you can see him fighting this internal, the struggle is so prevalent on his face, you can see him trying to swallow it down, it rises, then he pushes it down.
And that's also part of the importance of the dialogue between the showrunner and the star.
Right, that's what
to be able to say to Richard, the purpose of this scene is to carry the character to a point where he feels he's got nothing to lose. That's the intention of the scene. So he can find that in his performance, because he understands that's how far he's got to take it.
Yeah, see that dialogue, that's great. So that was a constant discussion, and that's a constant discussion that you're hearing as well, so that we have moments like that. And also, you know, there's quite a few lovely moments where Julie will give him a side glance. It's quite quick, but everything we need is in that beat. Is that something written, or is that something that's discussed on set?
They're usually written.
Yeah. Okay.
They're usually overwritten. So it's that I may write three or four of those particular beats consecutively.
Please write more of them.
but what I will say to the director or the cast is, don't worry about repetition, because we can always find the right balance in the edit. It's impossible to create those moments if you don't do it, but it's very easy to take them out.
Well, you know, it's so interesting, because, you know, a lot of people who are listening to this right now are, as you know, I think the reason the show was so well received was thematically, of course, it has so many things to it, but it's just so well made. And again, I think that's why it resonates. And for writers particularly, they're deeply enamored of the ability to keep interest not only sustained, but you really are on the edge of your seat with this. So writers who are looking at this, listening to this podcast now, there are thousands of them who are intrigued with this. What would you say, because, you know, you are so generous here and we're so grateful for you taking the time to talk with us today. What would you say to them is a good line of self-inquiry to find their voice, to find what kind of writer they are, even though I know it's a very personal process?
The first thing is to have confidence that your writing voice is coming through on the page. To be able to look at your script and not self-censor, that you feel that you can communicate directly with the reader. So you can add notes to stage direction or even lines of dialogue. Not constantly, because that makes it a hard read. But if you feel that you want to say that this particular line of dialogue or this particular action is something that has a very particular significance, then you should write that in the script. Just something very simple like that, so that you are attempting to convey to the reader how you imagine this will be performed, how you imagine this will look. And I know that there's kind of a template of writing very, very spare stage directions and very, very spare dialogue.
Mm-hmm. And it's a bit of an admonishment if one doesn't do that sometimes.
Yeah, but I think that you got to use your own judgment. If you read back your own work and you feel that your intention isn't coming through, then you can either change it so that it matches your intention, and that is definitely the preferred option.
Correct.
But if you do that and it still feels that there's a piece missing which allows the reader to understand what is going on here, then you should put it in the script. Even if it's something as simple as a character is lying, just put in brackets that they're lying.
Yeah, that's lovely. You know, it's sort of like in some of Pinter's screenplays, you see him do that. And I love what you're saying, to empower the writer to make sure that the intention, however they wish to get it across the page, they should do so. Other people may not be as aligned with that, but I think it's important, and from what I understand you're saying, that the writer makes sure that they're satisfied with what they're putting on the page, because that's why they're
there. And also, there's no good reason why anyone reading a script or anyone that you end up working with should object. That's another point to make.
That's great.
That if I was in a situation where a producer or a director or whoever it was said, well, it's not really your place to say this or that, then what that's telling me is that I shouldn't be working with that person. Because normally people are grateful for any insights into what the writer's intention is, because then that at least allows a basis for informed discussion. So if a director or a producer reads a screenplay and they just can't work out what you're trying to say, then that's a big problem. Whereas if there are clues in what you are doing that explain your intention, at least it allows them then to either embrace that intention or reject it in an informed way. The worst thing that you can do is self-censor to the point that it's not clear to a reader what story you're telling.
We're going to be wrapping up here in a moment, but I have to make sure and just emphasize to anyone hearing what Jed is saying here, I couldn't agree with you more. The confidence, the clarity, the forthrightness of what you're saying. Know what you're writing and know the value of what you're writing.
Yeah, and it's also about your place in the industry.
That's right. That's right.
If you have a meeting based on your work, and what you hear in that meeting is people pushing back your your position to influence what the final work is, then I would counsel against working with those people.
Yeah, that's beautiful. It's about integrity, I think. I think integrity and grace are often not articulated as being a barometer for taking meetings. And I think one's own sense of integrity and grace in a meeting is crucial, because I think we have to feel comfortable, right? You know, walking out of a room saying, I was the kind of writer in that room that I wanted to be. And I think that matters, because so much work and so much time goes into creating this. And, you know, you saying that and advising to that, it shows in your work, because you're very much a man who's very proud of what he does, and it's clear. And there's no push in that, which is quite lovely.
Well, I mean, I'm in a fortunate and privileged position to be the showrunner on shows that I create. Mm-hmm. But that wasn't always the case. Part of the reason that I've got to this position is that over the first, say, 5 years of my writing career, I started to become aware that there are collaborators out there who will not help your career. It's important that you're working with people who respond to your work, and that then creates a sense of collaboration and mutual respect, which allows the work to blossom and for you to be confident. The worst circumstance to be in as a writer is one where you're constantly being told that you're getting it wrong, and you then kind of wonder, what on earth is the point of this collaboration? Because I'm never getting it right. So where is this even leading?
Yeah, see, that's perfect, because I think what happens is then writers become extremely doubtful, which is the antithesis of what you're saying.
Cynical. And that's the real damage in particularly in the feature film industry, which I'm fortunate enough not to be part of, where you can end up in a situation where a writer knows that he or she is going to be fired. So right. The writer knows they're going to be fired. So why should they do their best work?
Well, that cynicism is insidious, and it affects all levels of the creative process. And that's when things become what they become, which is, you know, it's so good to hear that the work matters, you're saying, but also the process and in the writing of the work, the working with the collaborations. If you aren't enjoying that, and if that's not rewarding, and you feel respectful and done with integrity and a certain amount of grace and mutually beneficial work, then there's really no point. And it's important for writers to be aware of that, and to have the awareness enough to step away and know that they need to find someone else to work with them.
Exactly. I mean, you only need one good working relationship to propel you to the next level in your career. You don't, if you're working on, as most of us who are full-time writers, working on a multiplicity of projects that are in the development phase, you have to, because you that's the only way you can make a living until the point that something goes into production.
That's right.
You only need that positive relationship. All those negative relationships are worthless to you. There's 10 negative relationships are still worth less than one positive one.
I can't possibly ask you to give any more of your time, because quite frankly, that was the most exquisite finale. Mike is a very verbal man, because I could talk with you into the evening, ask for more, but I think that what you just said was so important for writers of this podcast and writers everywhere to hear, that one positive collaboration is really all that's necessary, and the rest simply don't matter. It's just such a truly brilliant insight, and it's a true thing. And I can't thank you enough for taking the time. You know, I know you hear this often, but your work is absolutely breathtaking, and it's just wonderful to watch such command of craft and authenticity. And so it's just lovely. And I cannot thank you again for taking the time to speak with us on Final Drafter today.
No, it's been an absolute pleasure. I've enjoyed it, and I hope it was helpful.
It was more than helpful. It really was. You have a lovely rest of your evening.
Thank you. And you. Thanks.
Right.
Bye.
Bye now.
Thank you, Michael C. Bryan. Thank you, Jed Mercurio. Thank you to all of our subscribers, and thanks to everyone who's left us all those ratings and reviews on iTunes. You can stay in the know by following us on Facebook or find us on Twitter as @FinalDraftInc and Instagram as @FinalDraftScreenwriting. I'm Pete D'Alessandro. Until next time, write on.